Welcome to Cut to the Chase with Jen and Dan. Today we're kicking off a new series, Love Local, where we're talking with different people in our community because it seems like everyone is spending less time together, separated in our own homes. But really, we have a great opportunity to talk to one another through Zoom and other online mediums and learn about how everybody is doing things differently. So we're getting to know our neighbors, and we're kicking off our first episode right now.
All right, awesome. So welcome to Cut to the Chase, Emmett. Thanks so much for joining us. Do you mind just introducing yourself real quick, you know, who you are, what you do?
Yeah, thanks so much for having me on. My name's Emmett Soldati. I'm the owner of Teetotaler, which is a cafe in Somersworth, New Hampshire. We have been here for almost 10 years. And our cafe, physical dine-in establishment and performance space is closed to the public, we have found some pretty interesting ways to stay connected with our audience and community.
I'm so awesome. Excited to dive into all of that, but can you tell us about the wall? I'm loving the wall behind you.
It's behind me, yeah. So this is not a green screen that I, you know, found on the internet. This is our wall. We actually, Food Network described us or named us one of the most Instagrammable restaurants in America.
Wow.
Literally just because of this wall. I mean, we have some other pretty things here too, but it was a blank white wall for the first 2 years we were open here, and it got dirty easily, as white walls in restaurants tend to do. So I just decided to paint it one winter when we were closed during an avalanche or a snowstorm. That's the Teetotaler wall. Many a presidential candidate has been in front of this wall. It sort of became an iconic location to take photos with presidents that were stumping, none of whom are the Democratic nominee, but they at least came here and gave us their time.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I love it. It's beautiful.
Yeah, it definitely is an eye catcher for sure. Especially when you like walk in and it's like right there on your right. It's really great.
It's also definitely a testament to the fact that like I can't draw a straight line. Like this is all like little like hand drawn lines that. You know, that's sort of, you know, Teetotaler is a little bit, you know, outside the edges.
That's what makes it so perfect.
Yeah, I think that makes it definitely even better. So Emmett, like how or like why did you get into business like as a having a coffee shop?
So I am a townie. I'm like from Somersworth, the littlest city in New Hampshire. And I had a lemonade stand on the corner of Washington and Main Street growing up. And I thought that would bring in a lot of money. I think I made about $16 a day during the summer.
Probably as a kid, that was a lot though.
It was a lot of money. Like, yeah. And I blew it all on like candy down at Care Pharmacy and ate it in an hour. My dental bill is like a total other conversation. But so, you know, I've loved the town and I kind of had this like, you know, fun little entrepreneurial, tiny, you know, entrepreneurial spirit. And I moved back to Somersworth after college because I felt like the rest of the world was like very much lacking in community and providing me a sense of belonging. And that's what Somersworth provided, but I didn't want to just, you know, sit around. So I decided to open an upgraded lemonade stand, a cafe. And I called it Teetotaler, which was just, you know, that's what a 22-year-old does when they think they have a good idea. It's a pun for someone that doesn't drink alcohol, Teetotaler. I had started my own journey into sobriety in 2010. So I was a teetotaler and I was also a tea drinker. And, you know, I put the two together. I just thought I was a genius. And still to this day, nobody can pronounce it. And they are embarrassed to say it. But that was Teetotaler, and we raised some money on Kickstarter. That was like back when Kickstarter just launched. You know, I had $60,000 in student debt at the time, no background in business or finance or really having any money. So I raised a little bit of money on Kickstarter and I found this abandoned storefront on the sort of what you'd call the backside of our downtown, across from a giant abandoned factory, and next to a strip of other abandoned storefronts. You get the picture, but it was cheap, and it was just like a lot of elbow grease and sweat equity. Turned it into this tiny little tea cafe that just kind of over the years, and it, well, initially over the days, like very quickly, you know, it's like, oh, we need to serve food or we need to serve coffee. Like, oops, that was stupid of me not to think about that. And so we kind of adapted and responded very quickly to just, I mean, not to make money, but like just to pay the electric bill was sort of the first step one. But what I found over the couple of years is, though it was very modest in its success, its financial success, it, because it was kind of unique and colorful and queer and odd, it started to attract a lot of people in the surrounding community, you know, not just Somersworth, not just Berwick, Maine, but, you know, from Portsmouth to Portland, really, that were kind of interested, and their interest was piqued in this kind of queer, colorful little cafe called Teetotaler, or Teatotaler, or Teatotal, however they say it. And that just kind of really, you know, fed my soul for feeling like, okay, if I'm not going to make money running a little cafe restaurant, I'm going to really find that community that I had, you know, definitely had when I was a kid. But you meet so many more people when you create space that isn't work, that isn't school, that isn't home. It's the sort of new third space that people can congregate and interact with. And, you know, we were small, so it was very easy and intimate to talk. You know, everyone could come in and they could talk to me. It wasn't a sort of faceless restaurant. And so, yeah, that just kind of kept going. And I did other things in the community. I opened other restaurants and bakeries in the course of 10 years. I got involved with other organizations and companies. But Teetotaler is the one thread and entity that existed throughout all of this.
That's awesome.
That's fantastic. I love the idea of a community within a community.
We are a community within a community within a community.
it's a Russian doll.
Mm-hmm. We're still looking for the kernel. We haven't gotten there yet.
So I have to say, I've been dying to ask you, one of the things you've been doing since the stay-at-home order is you've been doing doorstep boba tea delivery. Can you tell us about that and the response? Dan told me about it. I was like, what? That is the best idea ever.
I'm glad you think so. It just sort of, like every crazy idea that has happened and germinated out of Teetotaler, that is yet one iteration. So, you know, we had for a long time sold bubble tea on our menu, which is a Taiwanese drink, very popular in the 90s and 2000s in like big cities, and to this day is very popular. And it's usually like a milky beverage, like a chai, but there's, you know, dozens and dozens or hundreds of flavors, but it has these like little gummy, they're called tapioca pearls, but it's just like little semi-sweet gummies, flavorless really, in the bottom of your cup. So it's like you can enjoy the little gummies as part of the beverage. Very hard to explain. Dan's tried it, so could give the full.
Oh, they're awesome. I'm sad that I have not yet had yours. I actually, you know, I need to order up a doorstep.
So you're familiar, but for your subscribers and listeners,
yeah, exactly,
the audience. So it's, you know, it's called bubble tea or boba tea or milk tea. And we've always had it. And it's always been like one of those things for our business that was like, oh, that's kind of cool and cute and different. And, you know, you not only can you not find that in Somersworth, you can't find it in New Hampshire, really. And that was always part of our ethos, is to kind of bring some new, interesting, exciting flavors and ideas to folks. And so we always had that. And the shelter at home, like, you know, executive order to close down for dine-in establishments was around like March 15th. And we'd actually already made the decision for our business to close, not even from a governmental, you know, order perspective, but just economically, I wasn't going to be able to pay my staff if someone got sick, if I got sick, or, you know, if people just stopped coming. So we had actually already been closed when that came down, but we had planned on St. Patrick's Day. Every year we have Shamrock Bubble Tea Day. Oh, and fun. It's sort of minty green milk bubble tea. Very green. There is lots of food coloring in it. And you know, it's like $2. We sell it for $2, which is like less than half the price. And so it's like this nice little fun treat. And you know, we would get lots of people to come into the shop for it. And I didn't know what was going on. We were closed. I had no staff. I didn't know what my life was going to look like for a week, 2 weeks. And so I was like, well, maybe I'll just deliver. You know, we have a van that we use for like farmers markets and catering. It's like, I could just pack up the van with a bunch of bubble teas and travel around. So I like very quickly like updated our online store, cleared everything out. And I was like, you can only get Shamrock bubble tea and you have to order it and we'll come deliver. And I put like a 15-mile radius, which in hindsight was like a really bad idea. That's like actually very far. Oh. You know, live and learn. And so I put that up and it was like hundreds of orders came in.
Wow.
And we don't ever have hundreds of orders ever on a given day at the store.
Wow.
And, you know, so at first I was like, okay, I mean, first of all, that was a miserable day. It was like 10 hours of, let me drive to the edge of North Berwick and Wells and then down to like, you know, Durham, Newmarket, and, you know, it was interesting.
We understand as realtors.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I got a showing up there. And, you know, they say they live in Rochester, but it's like Rochester goes for years.
It's huge.
So I did that and it was very successful. And, you know, in some ways, you know, brought a little money in. And so my next thought was, and this is something that all of the restaurants went through, is they closed on March 15th. But they had payroll commitments for a future payday to pay at least the 1 week that they were open if they're on a two-week pay schedule. And so I was in the same boat where I have no more money coming the door. I still have other bills. And I have a couple thousand dollars I need to make just to meet my half commitment payroll. And this, you know, there's no stimulus funds yet. There was no like help out. So I was like, okay, you know what? I could probably do a couple more bubble tea days, fix it up, tweak it a little bit here and there, and it pulls some money in. So added some more flavors. Some people hate the Shamrock bubble tea. I'm one of those people. I think it tastes like toothpaste, but I love people that love it. But there's some other, like Thai bubble tea, amazing, delicious. You know, we get mocha, so we got some coffee and
I really love the mocha for the coffee drinkers. Yeah, I had that one this week and it was really good.
So we added those flavors and put out the store. And at that point I had kind of like figured out the system a little better, the driving, you know, reducing where we go to, the routes. And over the next week, we were able to bring in enough money to meet my payroll commitment. And so then at that point, everyone's like, well, I want bubble tea every week or every day or whatnot. And so it was not with a plan initially. It was kind of just responding to the needs of our customers and our team. And it has turned into like just like a wonderful way of bringing people joy.
And it started because you were really trying to take care of the people that work for you too.
Yeah, it was definitely like mindful of that. The other thing too, because I've talked to a lot of small business owners that like right on the March 15th and that week were like in shock and, you know, maybe a little bit of mourning. And the one thing I felt sure about in such a level of uncertainty for in terms of a timeline, and this is the thing I told many people, is do not bank on making any money right now. Do not bank on making any money for the foreseeable future. But the one thing you need to make sure is that you build up or maintain the presence of your company. And, you know, treat Facebook like in the same way, the same kind of currency that you would treat a transaction. Because, you know, let's assume, and we didn't know, but like in a couple months from now, we're going to reopen and everything's normal and there's a vaccine and whatnot. The last thing you want is someone goes to search for, you know, coffee in Somersworth and teetotaler's nowhere visible on Google and is in nobody's feed because I haven't been active and I haven't been engaged. And so for me, the sort of number one rule was stay relevant, because that's going to make the kind of onboarding, you know, the reintroduction, whatever it might be called, right, easier. You know, so because now it's like I have people regularly texting, emailing me because of this little business model that I'm going to be able to send a blast. It's like, hey, grand opening, or there's a party or whatnot, rather than people being like, oh, did they close permanently or have they not opened yet? Or, you know, so it was to support the team, but it was also kind of to support the brand and the soul of the business, for what we've done for, you know, for the community.
I love it. And it's made your community bigger and even, you know, more special than it was originally. More the merrier.
Totally. You know, there's, like I said, like we got hundreds of orders. The Teetotaler, I think, has always had a pretty kind of, you know, bold reputation, colorful reputation. And that, you know, really travels. You know, there's so many people I know in Portsmouth that talk up Teetotaler and love Teetotaler. But the reality is, from a retail perspective, you know, these weren't people that were coming in on a Tuesday to get lunch. These aren't people that were regulars that lived in, you know, Portland, even if they liked or engaged with our brand. And the delivery aspect, which, you know, dumb business mind that I have, never occurred to me. The moment I said, you know what, I'm going to bring this to you, you know, and there's something about bubble tea that's like feels very teetotaler.
Yeah.
So many more people were available, you know, so many more people were like, yeah, we'll sign on. And so I've almost been able to kind of take advantage of all of that goodwill in the community, and help it create a sustainable business model.
I love that. And yeah, you're spreading happiness in a cup everywhere.
Exactly. You know, I don't want to be, you know, this sort of essential side of, you know, like I think if you need food or you need some other, you know, PPE, you know, it's like, it's very strict and it's scheduled and it's structured and there's expectations. And in some ways I actually like the business model I'm developing, because 2 months ago I could never be like, hey, order bubble tea and it'll get there when it gets there. Mm. You know, you'll be like, well, but I have a meeting or I have to go out, or, you know, whereas it's like people are mostly at home. People love bubble tea at all hours and all temperatures. You know, this isn't like you're ordering your Grubhub and you need it there for your meeting, for lunch for everyone. And I don't want to dwell on building a business model based on how people were working 2 months ago. I actually kind of like, you know, the slack that's afforded now.
Yeah, it's nice because when I ordered mine on Friday, it said, you know, it'll come between 10 and 4. And, you know, I was like, I was thinking the same thing. I was like, whenever it gets here, it's like, you know, it'll just be like a fun thing to have on a nice Saturday, especially where the weather was supposed to be so great and stuff. So I think it's cool how the business models of different, I mean, we're seeing things changing in our business too. And it's cool how how everybody's doing stuff that's a little bit different. Do you have any, like, has it given you any like ideas for, you know, what you might do like after all this stuff is over?
Yes. And I think one of the ideas it's given me, and just to sort of almost push back on the question, I don't know what will be over, you know, because in some ways we have been able to tap into something that's more sustainable for our business. And so, and again, I'm speaking about restaurants, which are always precarious, always seasonal. It may be different seasons depending on your area. Always low margins, so kind of, you know, really exposed to swinging, to being in the red. And what I've currently built in the foreseeable future is not that. And so it's nice to have a business model that doesn't feel like I'm working 80 hours a week, mm-hmm, to maybe lose my shirt. And I feel safer about rehiring all my employees now, or all my full-time employees, because I feel confident that, like, oh, there's a very solid, much more reliable revenue stream, much more predictable revenue stream, at least, that it feels more responsible. And so I am not approaching this any longer from the perspective of this is my stopgap, or I'm going to do this until I'm very much approaching it as this is my business. And it is unlikely that our physical location will open anytime soon. Mm-hmm. regardless of what the governor or the state may say, restaurants cannot afford to be open if they even have a 5% drop in traffic or a 10% drop in traffic, which just could be the case. So I'm, to me, the biggest surprise will be when we reopen. But in terms of what I know, I actually know that Doorstep Boba and some other, you know, online, you know, live streams and other forms of programming, that is my business today. And that is my business for the foreseeable future.
I love that. Can you tell us a little bit more, tell our audience, about some of the other things that you do? I know you have a performance element to your business as well, which I think is fantastic.
Yeah, so we have always had a stage at our cafe. And again, sort of in the ethos of the name being an alcohol-free establishment, means that all of our programming is alcohol-free. And, you know, that doesn't mean we close at 5 and, like, no nightlife. Like, you know, Friday, Saturday nights, we almost always had something happening. And it meant a lot of our programming was all ages, which doesn't exclusively mean it was youth-oriented. Like, you know, we would have, you know, variety shows with, like, lots of great acts of all sorts. You know, once in a while we would have like a queer burlesque show and that would be 18 plus. But for the most part, all ages. One of our shows that was our most popular was a teen drag show called the After School Special.
Oh, that's awesome.
So cool.
And it is a teen drag show because the performers are all teenagers. Anyone in the audience, you know, all ages, you know, folks our age, the parents of the kids, whatnot. But amazing, amazing performers, like 16 and 17 year olds that had just been practicing in their parents' basement and, you know, have all of the moves and the makeup and the hair and so forth down. So that was always wonderful. And so it's like, well, yeah, of course we can't, you know, cause that would have like 70 folks here, maybe 50, maybe the fire marshal's listening, 50 folks here on a given night. You know, we can't do that. We can't do that for the foreseeable future, but that was unique to us and that was special for us. And so we've been able to tap into that to like very quickly do a lot more live streaming programming, whether on Instagram or Facebook. And, you know, again, that's one of those things too, where like there's a lot of people that are going live. It's like very easy to go live. And maybe there's some fatigue. But I think what Teetotaler has been able to do is translate its brand to these people to say, hey, like you always loved the kind of production values and what you would expect to get. And so that is almost like a promise that we make, you know. So our online show is not going to be me just kind of like, boop, like I'm going to just go live. It's going to be thought out. And so like, you know, we had a birthday variety show and it went for an hour and we had like 150 people on there. And it's like we've never had 150 people come see a show here. They wouldn't fit. So just trying to find ways to, you know, keep that side of things alive. And again, the goal is not to monetize it. It is not to exhaust people and be like, you know, here's the scheduled slate of shows every night this week. But really to respond to a need to stay connected to these sort of expressive, talented, you know, people and groups and so forth. And there's little venue to do that. Because I think the one thing that would be unfortunate, we mentioned Netflix earlier before this started recording.
Right.
A lot of people are on Netflix. A lot of people are hanging at home watching, you know, their Hulus. And I've gotten into doing that myself for the first time in my life. And so we see that like a lot of streaming services are up. It would be very unfortunate if we came through this pandemic and this process to be more connected to Hollywood and less connected to our home communities. So it's really important that whether they're individual theaters or concert venues or halls, really find a way to engage their audience and not bore their audience and not overwhelm their audience, because otherwise we're going to leave thinking the whole world is still in Los Angeles. And so much of what Teetotaler did when it was open is it gave people a sense of there is creative, stimulating activity and programming and vibrancy in my backyard. And we need to make sure that people still feel like they have that in their backyard online.
Yeah, and something else that's really important about, you know, what you're providing, you know, both with the bubble tea delivery and, you know, with your online performances is, a break from the stay-at-home feeling and the worried feeling, which is something that everybody deals with differently, but that we don't have a really good, how to fix it, what to do about it. And so, you know, we can see your performances. We can tune in for the first time and maybe feel like we went out, we went out of our house, you know, we get out of our routine, we, you know, we're inspired by something or thought about something different, got out of our head. You know, we can have that treat, you know, instead of whatever we just signed on for that, you know, we had in our fridge. So, you know, that's a really valuable thing right now. And I don't think, as much as we talk about how practical, you know, especially people in the food industry are, like, what you're providing is actually, like, human helpful. So I'm really excited about, you know, that component of what you bring as well.
Yeah, we do, and we've definitely gotten feedback like that, even with the bubble tea, where, you know, a lot of people shifted, you know, and they could have any number of jobs or work in an office that's like, okay, we're all working remote. We have Zoom meetings and whatnot. And that feels, I think, a little bit like you're kind of caged in with just like waiting for this to end. And you're just sort of, again, like mourning the loss of, oh, remember when we did this? Remember when we used to do this? And to me, Doorstep Bubble Tea is about providing like a little experience, miniature experience that is meant for now. It's you know, it's meant to be a fun little moment for shelter at home and all this stuff. It might not have that effect or be as meaningful at a time where someone's like, I can walk outside and go buy bubble tea down the street. And, you know, there's people that have set up, they've created bubble tea stands. So people like build, I mean, I don't think anyone's building it, but like they create a little desk, you know, bedside table type thing that they paint or they put outside with a sign on it in a dedicated spot, which is like great for us. It's like very efficient. You know, it's like it's like your mailbox or where the you know, that box that you used to get for your paper.
Bubble tea here.
Exactly. It's bubble tea here. And it's just like when the milkman, it's like the milkman knew exactly where to leave the bottles. So that operationalizes my business. Like, oh, they know, drop it there. They're good. Maybe I'm hopefully soon people put like a little buzzer on it. Like I don't even need to text them. I just, you know, your boba's here.
Boba buzz.
The boba buzz. And we can go into business together. I like this. And I think that's the thing too, that people are down to be like, oh, you know, I can create a new little routine for me and, you know, based around this thing, because I'm not going to sit around waiting for it all to just magically be reverted. Mm-hmm. And so I'm using Teetotaler as best we can to kind of tap into what are some sort of fun new ways we can deliver more than bubble tea, but really, yeah, really deliver joy and some kind of connective tissue to their community at their doorstep.
Well, and I feel like it makes you have a feeling of community too, even though you're at your house, because when you're looking on Instagram or whatever, and you see like you see other people's stories with like posting their photos. And I think I saw the one that you're talking about, what they had the bedside table or whatever it was. And so you're like, wow, other people are doing the same thing and they're excited about it too. And just like the way that it just engenders goodwill is just, it's excellent. And it's great for people feeling isolated right now. So it's like great to just make people feel like they're part of a community in some way. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think the thing is, when you had asked earlier about like, you know, what's next as things, you know, go back, I think the thing for us is to go forward is, how can we do more of that? And we have some ideas in the works for sure about, you know, we're already going to people's doors. We're bringing them something that's special. And like, how can we bring something that's more special or, you know, more fun or more interactive? And that's what we're going to keep doing.
That's great. I mean, there's so much room for innovation right now. And I think there was so much technology and stuff that we weren't using that we're starting to use now. So it's going to be, it's going to be kind of exciting, I guess, in a way to see like how we utilize all of that stuff and move it forward into the future, because there's so much, you know, so much possibility.
Oh, totally. And one of the things, so I try to do my best to kind of share skills and pass on with other small business owners, whether food service or Main Street businesses or not. And one of the things, you know, so I, at 5 o'clock today, like, you know, I have a little live stream on my Instagram about connecting with other small business owners. And, you know, the topic today and the topic that's been on everyone's mind is all the stimulus funding and the Paycheck Protection Program loan program and the forgiveness and so forth. And I guess sort of to give away, you know, the ending of what I'm going to share on my live stream is the thing that I tell people and the thing that I hear that's successful from other businesses is, okay, use all of this stimulus and this funding as an opportunity to invest in something you never would have ventured into, rather than trying to prop up and subsidize your business model from February. Because true, maybe your business will revert back to normal and so forth, but any of the things that you could do, whether it's hiring a graphic designer for the first time or a copy editor or a web designer or whatnot, will be useful to both business models. And, you know, so like if you need to hire, you need to spend payroll dollars in the next 7-8 weeks, like why? I've seen a couple businesses reopen, you know, still safe delivery, curbside, whatever, but reopen just to pay their employees to fulfill it. And it's like, that's great. That's circulating money. But another way we could be circulating money is investing in things that makes your business more resilient and stronger and adaptive 6 months from now, 12 months from now, because there's no guarantee I'm going to have another $10,000 grant from the federal government that has no, virtually no strings attached. So I could either use that money to just, you know, oh, we're going to sell avocado toast out of the front of our door for 8 weeks and then that dries up and then we stop that. Or I'm going to, you know, develop an app that allows people to, I'm going to develop the Boba Buzz and everyone gets a little intercom for their door. You know, like these are the things I could spend my money on now that I don't see the downside.
That's so, those are such great ideas. And this won't be out before 5 o'clock today, so don't worry.
Yeah, you're gonna be like
breaking news.
We're gonna post it really quick as soon as we get off of here. No, I'm just kidding. Those are great ideas. I think that those are really awesome and goes to, and I think it just goes to show of different ways that people can innovate and giving people ideas and stuff is really awesome too, because you know, I always find working with other people and masterminding ideas like is the way that we create better ideas. So I think that's an awesome thing as well.
Yeah. And the thing I'm seeing, and maybe different industry, it's different. You know, the food service industry has a high number of employees that are very disenfranchised from their business. And, you know, even myself, I think of myself as a, you know, progressive, supporter, you know, workers, whatever. There are many times throughout a decade of running a business that you do feel like you can't share with your employees and you do feel like you need to kind of sit above it all. And this experience has taught me, and I've seen a couple other people where I'm going to be completely transparent with my team. I'm going to be like, here's exactly how much money I have in the bank account. Here's exactly what I am going to spend it on, or I'm thinking of spending it on, in some ways because I need to, because, you know, I'm like calculating, okay, I have to hit 75% of my PPP loan goes to payroll. So if I pay you blank and you're working this many hours, and that level of transparency and honesty, I think is good from both just a relational perspective, but it's also empowered my team and in some ways revealed some people's skills and ideas that otherwise wouldn't have stepped up to the plate to recommend something or insert themselves and say, hey, I could do this or I could help this way. And the food service industry is in desperate need of making more use of people's kind of value and what they bring to bear. And I think the only way you do that is you include them in the creative and financial part of the business. And so I'm hoping that there's less of this disenfranchisement that happens where I'm the boss and I'm just going to delegate these tasks to you. And I'm so smart. I know what's going on, where I'm like, I don't really know. And so like, you know, if you know, or, you know, if one of my employees, like if you want to set up our Snapchat, which we've never done for our business, like how would that affect selling bubble teas or whatnot? So that's been very important to me to use this opportunity to give more credit and time and value to my team without trying to overburden them or being like, oh, now here are the keys, it's yours. But that's been good.
So you mentioned some ideas that you had, or anything like your for the future that you're thinking of, like ideas that you had to maybe expand your doorstep stuff. Anything you want to share now, or are they still in the works?
Secrets. Okay. Let's see.
Share your secrets.
Is there anything you can tease out?
Well, I mean, it's not so much that they're like, I'm secrets. It's more like we have a lot of ideas and then I'm going to like say it and then they'll never happen. They're like, but I think a couple things, like we've already seen, like we like to give little messages in people's cups, and we're looking at ways to make that more interactive and make it more of like maybe some games that people can play. Nice. So they can kind of look forward to it. Or, you know, we do have a lot of families. So it's like people buying a bubble tea for them, their spouse and their kids. Mm-hmm. And so ways that we can make that experience of receiving the bubble tea more like, oh, and we got a little game, just like you would play a game at Friendly's with the pegboard and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Again, that idea of just like it kind of extending the joy a little bit. Another big thing is, where are the teen drag queens and why aren't they delivering you bubble tea? And, you know, throw a little boom box on top of the van and do a death drop right when you deliver the bubble tea. So just like,
we're going to need supplies for some high quality drag masks though. I mean, we need some like good artistic.
We have some great, we've got some cool masks. We definitely, I think we're waiting. I think the next wave will be this. Yeah. The glamification of PPE. We're going to see some people on RuPaul's Drag Race, I'm sure, but we've gotten some pretty crafty, creative people already. I think there's just opportunities to engage people and be more creative and artistic and more vibrant. And it was only one, I talked about, oh, it was just the Shamrock bubble tea, I'll do that. And then it's like, oh, I just gotta make some money to pay the bills. Once I finally accepted, like, oh, I'm the owner of Doorstep Boba, like I'm not just the owner of Teetotaler. That's the space where I started to think about being creative, or let's go to Concord and do this. And like, let's see if we can do a pop-up and test that out. So these are some of the things we'll experiment more with.
That's really cool.
I love it.
Yeah.
So yeah, our whole idea, as we said before we started, was who are the people in your neighborhood? And I'm so excited that you came on the show today to share everything you've been working on. I hope it's as helpful for everyone listening as it was for me, and I know for Dan, because we have so much in common, business-wise, human-wise, fun-wise. So thank you so much for your time and for coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for having me. I'm sure I'll, deliver some bubble tea to your doorstep very soon.
I have three teenagers, so I have to be like, all right, we're going to bubble tea it up. I got to figure out when we're
doing it. Well, we got some new flavors coming out on May 2nd or whatever.
Oh, so. Maybe I'll tell them that's what I want to figure out sometime near Mother's Day. I'll be like, we're going to bubble it up sometime near Mother's Day.
Bubble tea.
Yeah, thank you again, Emmett. It was really great to have you on. So awesome to hear, what people are doing, like what you're doing to help the community and to keep your business and, to help your business to evolve and stuff. So we're super excited to see that. So yeah, thank you so much again.
Awesome. Thanks guys. It's a real pleasure.
All right. Great.
Bye.
Bye.